put your perspective panel. Mr. Susan Kibulsina again. I would like to request you to come up on stage as I introduce your names. And once again, humble apologies if I get your names incorrect. I'm really sorry. Next we have Ms. Nina Jaklojevic, a talented singer from Serbia, who co-founded the bands Escadrilla and Hands, and has also won the first voice of Person Media and Francophone Song Contest. Next, Mr. Gaurav Pokhrel, one of the six finalists of Glocal Teen Hero 2015, who was awarded with Best Journalist and also the Youngest Journalist in the year 2015. Next we have Mr. Insaf Pokhrel, a Nepali teenager working on various youth issues for over 5 years under various organizations. And lastly, Mr. Kelvin Alfayet Lugiano, chairman of a children's forum in 2015, all the way from Indonesia, who's currently volunteering to teach children. Please join me in welcoming them all with a huge round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. Let me now welcome our moderator, a very versatile and multi-talented personality of Glocal Private Limited, none other than our very own General Manager of Glocal Private Limited, Ms. Alina Prajapati. Please raise a hearty welcome to her. Let me now hand over the floor to our moderator. Thank you.
So much, Drishti. Well, I think it's still the morning. Yes? Okay. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
You guys are bored? No? Tired? No? Since this panel is social perspective, and we're talking about social things is related to each and every part of you, each and every part of us, and each and every part of this world. So I'm really happy to moderate this panel because the one thing is I have freedom to talk about anything about the society and not specifically limited to one topic. I am also grateful to all the moderators from Nepal, Indonesia, and Serbia. And Srizo, you had your presentation was, I was not in the teen conference actually. I was somewhere in the, very respected, very senior priest or like, not relating you to priest, but somewhat very experienced, personalities. So it was really amazing. Thank you so much, Treason. Well, I think you have heard about Nina. We have a singer here. I think I request Nina to sing a few, few lines of the song, maybe Serbian, because we all want to hear a song, isn't it? Yes. Let's give a round of applause for Nina.
Hello, everybody. I'm Nina. I hope you're having a great time. And first of all, I want to thank you for inviting me here in Nepal. This is an amazing country, and I met a lot of inspiring people. So thank you again, and I hope you will enjoy. Oh,
thinkings in the minds of various peoples. There are use of herbal medicines which dates back to centuries old, which is before the age of any other religion or anything out there in the entire earth. So these are the things. Also, there are various beautiful songs and the cultural songs, which are quite interesting for us. The customs that we have, and it's a fact, I hope so, most of us might not know, we have 242 different peoples of different caste and culture who speak different languages. So we are very, very diverse. And with the smallest, the lowest point of the world to the highest point, Mount Everest, we have each and everything. So we are diverse. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, Risa. That was a question, isn't it? Okay, I think, yes, we are excited, as interesting your song was. The most interesting part of your culture in Serbia, or your local community.
So yeah, Serbia has a very rich history. So in every single part of Serbia, we have different traditional outfits. So it's very interesting to see, because there was a period of time when we were under Turkish people, so we succeeded to save our letter and to save our tradition, our way of doing things. So that was very hard to do. And for example, we are Orthodox Christians and we have temples like monasteries, actually, from 12th century, from 13th century. They're very old and very interesting to see. So yeah, folklore is very, our traditional dance is a very huge part of our tradition. And a lot of kids from Serbia are training and they want to save everything because it's very interesting to see. And if you lose your letter or your tradition, you're not a nation anymore. You don't exist.
Okay. Gaurav?
I'm from Japan. In Japan, the lowest place of Nepal, Ketana Kabal lies. There are mainly Rajwanshi people, they have their own culture, they have their own dance, they have their own food, and there are other different community of other different kind of peoples. They all have their own separate culture and they have different songs in their own language. And in our community, there are different kind of festivals that are celebrated. Each of a group of community that celebrates different kind of festivals.
Thank you so much. Insa?
I'm from Rajnagar, Nepal. It's at the eastern side of Nepal. And talking about culture, every religion has a biggest day or the biggest festival in every culture. And ours, being a Hindu, is Dasari. But in Nepal, there is a different way of celebrating the same festival by the people of different places. We celebrate Dasari in our way, other people celebrate Dasari in their own way. So we can imagine how different the culture is here in Nepal. And talking about the ancient culture, we have various Darbar squares and various temples that were older than some of the countries of the world right now. So yes, we have a very diverse culture. And yeah, you can explore the city and have a look towards what we have. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Kevin, would like to share your interesting culture to every one of us.
Okay, thank you. So Indonesia has many, many thousand lands from Sabang to Merauke, and mostly 70% is currently water and 30% land. So that's very interesting. So many diversity in Indonesia. So many diversity and culture, and the government legalized 5 religions in Indonesia. There are Islam, Christian, Buddhist, Hindus, and Confucian. So Indonesia people have also tolerant to the other religions, have also pluralism. And the interesting about tourism is Indonesia have a Bali and Raja Ampat. Bali is the most favorite place to be visited for tourists going to Indonesia and also for Raja Ampat. So the government want to focus to make a trending to Raja Ampat to make a popular rather than Bali. And also the food, Indonesia has a very delicious food. And And the name is nasi rendang, rendang from Padang, and that's the most delicious food in the world from the version of the CNN, maybe? I forget the name of version. Yeah, that's it.
I mean, it's interesting to see though from the same country we have different interesting cultures, and yes, different countries have different interesting cultures. And linking this culture, now diverting it into your own dreams. Like, as Srizan mentioned in his presentation, we all have one common thing, is that we all are humans, and humanity exists because humans exist, right? So though from different cultures, though from different kind of outfit or different languages, every person and each one of you have your own desires and each one of you have your own dreams, right? So you all have been into different kind of fields, as a singer, or journalist, or activist, or anthropologist, you know. How do you get inspired to follow what you desire to be, like following your dream that we discussed in the first panel as well, focusing on your dreams, focusing on your goals, but then what is that one thing that makes you, you know, you get inspired to do that thing and follow your dreams?
Thank you.
Let me share my own story. Okay, a brief about my life. Now, I'm currently 19. I was studying in class 5, as far as I remember. I was interested in science since I was born. I was studying in class 5. I used to read articles about sciences in various places, like newspapers. But then a thinking came, why not write a book so that you can inspire more among a number of people, give more information. Then when I was studying in class 5 itself, I was 8 or 9 then. Then I published a book named Key Points of Science. That was made for class 5 students. I was myself studying in class 5. Now, next, moving on and researching in anthropology. From there, an amazing turn came in my life. I started researching in the field of anthropology. Now, basically, most of the people might not know what anthropology is, but it's about the evolution, how we evolved, how did we become humans, or Homo sapiens sapiens at all. How did we evolve from the Stone Age to tell what we are now? I researched, and in class 8 itself, I also had a dream to own my own Guinness Book of World Records, to become entitled as a Guinness Book of World Records holder. Why not do something great, live a mark on Earth? Then I went on searching for various opportunities, like which would be better. I went on searching, and lastly I found something. There is the longest title. Okay, of a book. Longest title of a book, it was that by the time I filled the form and got accepted, there was only 1,000 something characters were there in the title. By the time I applied, another guy from India itself had broken that record and held as 5,633 characters in the title itself. But mine, it now includes 16,375 characters with 1,816 words in the title itself. It is subtitled as The Brain, proposed in the Guinness Book of World Records, and then the process is going on. And this led me to think about anthropology. Now, I kept on searching this and that. Now, it was not until class 12 had ended, and I gave my examinations, and I was in the home. We had break almost 3-4 months. And then, suddenly, a new hypothesis came out of somewhere in my mind that was unknown to the entire world. Before that, when I was studying in class 9 itself, I hope everyone out here knows E equals mc squared of Einstein, that the same very formula used to use in various bombs and nuclear reactions. By that time, there was an experiment done, and the report came that neutrons are farther, faster than that at the speed of light. By this particular thing, I was able to successful to derive a new equation, not E equals mc squared, E equals me squared, another sign. And that was correct by that time. But later, the next following year, that particular experiment was proven wrong, that the neutrons fast, travel faster than the light, and light was again in the fastest of anything on Earth. Then the same thing came back again. My theory was correct till that particular phase. After that, since the experimental evidence was wrong, that went away. Similarly, I have many other hypotheses in field of cosmos for the entire universe as well. Then, as coming back to my anthropology work, by 12, I came with a new hypothesis. Now, I thought, why not just send it to international conferences? Now, I was amazed by that day when I wrote an abstract. I really knew nothing about writing an abstract. That was my first abstract I've ever written in my life. I sent it to Singapore. There was a conference on science. And then I sent it to Czech Republic. The second one letter came first as an SMS, that is from Czech Republic, then followed by Singapore, and invited me as an oral presenter delegate to share my research papers. Now that journey went on. After that also, I gave a new hypothesis. The hypotheses are regarding why we walk on two legs. No matter whom I ask this particular question, they say it's a great, why not walk on two legs? But the main story is why do we have bipedalism? That is one. Why is our cranial capacity, the human brain size, is decreased? Why is it decreased? And the other one, how have we evolved? I have given a new hypothesis regarding hormonality. From there, how we evolved until the Neanderthal, and how we, the modern humans, evolved. Now this this paper, I shared it to this international conference in NAS. This was organized by the National Academy of Science and Technology in Nepal itself. The 7th NAS conference, just last year, July 31st to 29th to 31st, 3 days program. And I was the youngest. The minimum, smallest age was 21, and I don't know how I went there, maybe 18 years old, among the youngest in the entire NAS conference. And that gave me a boost up to search further and further. Currently in various other, also that particular paper got accepted for presentation in Harvard University and Illinois State University of USA as well, and also in Switzerland and many other countries. And when I was in class 8, and I wrote the book, I was invited by many this radio programs in Youth FM, Citizen FM, and various other televisions, and I gave my interviews many 19 times, and the response to that particular interview was, I was amazed and shocked. The audience loved it so much that it went on repetition 7, 8, 9 times. 19 interviews only, and that went on for repeating 19 times. I was obliged, and that gave me a boost. I wish everyone a very good luck and chase your ambition, chase your dream in life, don't let your dream chase you. Thank you.
Well, that was amazing. I mean, in this case, I think you have went to universities like, and your topic is like so out of the world, you know. When we are curious, we're curious about, when I was teenager, I was curious about how movies made and how this music is composed, or let's say, how this food is made, or how can we dress up, you know, and then we follow someone else. You know, someone else's path, and your topic is about humans and how it's evolved. You've challenged Einstein equals to mc squared, and you know, something going out of the world. And I'm amazed to, you know, we all are amazed to hear what you have spoken about. You know, you've been called in so many countries and your research paper thing, because research paper easily is, I think we've done this in Nepal, it's doing PhD or doing master's, right? That's amazing. Thank you so much, Reza. And for Nina, my particular question is about, you know, you've mentioned that she's from a very small part of Serbia, where when she started singing, she has a passion in singing. There are no theaters, yes, there are no cinema halls where like music could be a part of, you know, everyone's, you know, or platform of music. And then she started a project of music, and you see, you've done amazing work. So what is that thing that inspired you to follow what others were not being able to do it in your community?
So, like you said, I live in a very poor small town in southern Serbia. So 30 or 40 years ago, Kosovo was totally different. We had a lot of cultural festivals and, you know, concerts, plays and stuff. theater, we have people who would make other people, you know, fight for their dreams. And then, because we live in such an area, you know, our history, like First World War, Second World War, we were bombarded in 1999, and like, wars are coming to us like every 15, 20, 30 years, so it affects people. Sometimes I think that people in my town and in southern Serbia, they have fear to be happy and to fight for their dreams because they think the bad times will come again. So they are giving up. And when I was younger, I loved singing, dancing and acting. So I have an older brother, and together we collected a group of friends. We would make concerts for our parents, for our friends, for our neighbors. And they would enjoy. We would have so much fun. So when I grew up, I mean, when I started elementary school, I wanted to continue that. I wanted to do what I love. I wanted to inspire people to just do what they love without fearing, without being afraid. And we, especially me, I didn't have any choice, I mean, any support. My professors, they didn't want to help us at all. They had their work and that's it, nothing beside that. They didn't want to spend their free time preparing us or teaching us something new, something that we don't know. So I decided that it would be the best if I practiced on my own. So I started singing in my room for myself, for no one. And I started like going to competitions and I was awful. So awful, but I didn't want to give up because I knew how my city was awesome 30 years ago. And I don't want for my friends, for my neighbors, for my citizens to live such a boring and useless life. We have so many talented kids, music, science, and it's pity to not share that with the world. It's pity for them to do nothing in their life if they're talented. Yeah, so when I was 7th grade, I had 13 years then, I heard about Office for Young People. And I was shocked because I never heard for such an organization before in my city. We don't even have a cinema or theater, I don't know if I mentioned that, like anything at all, any cultural building. So I was very shocked to hear about it. When I went there with my friends, we asked them what are they doing, what their goal. So they told us about that they have like two rooms with two ordinary computers and they have one acting group. So when we heard what they have and what they're doing, they asked us if we would like to join. And nobody raised their hand, just me. So I started like an actress, but we were making humanitarian plays for people and nobody would come. Like we would make plays for two or five people. And then we had an idea that I could sing and we would call a lot of neighbors, a lot of people from school. And in the first place, we were begging them to come to see, to try. And then a lot more people would come to watch us. All our concerts and plays were humanitarian character, so we would give that money we earned for the people that they needed the most. And now, a few years later, the situation is definitely way better than a couple years ago. So after those humanitarian concerts at the beginning, we had an idea to write projects. We wanted for next generations to have more than we had. We wanted them to introduce like guitars, piano. We don't have music school in our town at all. So we wanted them to try, just to try. And if they love playing some instrument or drawing or something like that, they can have a chance to do it. First of all, we made singing workshops and a lot of kids came to us and they wanted to join us. So after that went successfully, we earned money from that project and we bought the equipment that we needed. And after that, we had piano workshops, guitar workshops, blues and jazz workshops, art workshops, More and more children wanted to help us. They wanted to make a future for themselves. So together, we are making a better future for everyone. Together, we can change the world.
I mean, I would give a round of applause to Nina for her initiative. When I think if the apple was not fallen on the head of Newton, we would not find Newton's law of motion. And similarly, as curious as Newton was, and as the initiation that Newton took, similar cases with Nina where there are no traitors, and the country is so backward in expressions or in the music, and with her initiation, with one project to just let students come and play and sing, and you know, you were trying to make this a humanitarian concert, and I mean that's a huge amount of you know, state to, though it's a very small state for your amazing future, this state will actually, it's a pivotal stone for everyone else. And my question to you again is about, you know, we talked about here in Nepal or any other South Asian countries, we discussed in the previous panel discussion, look for doctors and engineers. You want to be a painter, you want to be a singer, you want to be an artist, you take this as a hobby, and it just fades away. Though you have, you know, we have workshops, we have instruments, we have every facilities, but then it's not that there is no facilities, but it's that we are not taking our guts out to take that step to follow our dreams. And here you are, there are nothing to facilitate the singing, and you are telling that statement like going opposite. So how does your parents or how does your friends support you? Do they, you know, feel the same way how our parents feel about you should be a doctor, engineers, something like that? Can you share a little bit about that?
Yes, so well, I wanted to say first that parents are parents. So it doesn't matter if they're from Nepal, from Serbia, America, Britain, it doesn't matter. Parents are parents and they worry about you and they only want the best for you. So you need to prove them that you are good enough and that you're enjoying the things that you're doing. That you want to be successful even though they are trying to make you doctors, engineers and stuff like that. I live in a family where my mother is a pharmacist, my brother is a pharmacist, everyone is in science. And I plan to go on molecular biology later. But actually, my biggest wish is to sing and act and dance. So when I started, I had the support of them, of course, but they were not so happy because, like some of you said, they thought that my education will, you know, start to be bad. But I just found a balance, and that is very important. You need to find a balance so it, nothing goes bad.
Thank you so much, Nina. Now my question to Gaurav is, you know, he's a journalist and awarded as the youngest journalist, right? Since this small is years into journalism, and journalism is one of the profession where it's the most riskiest profession in Nepal a few years ago, before democracy was here. And before it was Republican, you can see even in the eastern part, the journalists are being killed, are being, into, you know, kidnapped with many things. How did you come up with the idea to focus and come in this field, tirelessly working day and night? Because the job of journalist is you don't have nights and days. You have to go to reporting anywhere, anytime, in any situations that happens. So how did you manage to, you know, manage, or like let's say, how did you aspire to be a journalist and to be forever, like till now and forever?
Thank you for the question. Firstly, when I was reading in class 4, my father used to write poems and I used to recite that. And at that time, he used to bring different newspapers and I used to see that I find my father's name in that newspaper. And other different persons, byline also I used to see in that newspapers. And seeing those bylines and that willingness, by that willingness to see my by name in that newspaper, I started to write a poem. And later on, I started working with a child club, and in that club, I started reading different magazines, newspapers, day by day, and I didn't find that issues of children in first phase, second phase, the issues of children were not given priority. And I always think why children's issues are not given priority, why their issues are only given very less space. And I thought from that time I'll start this journalism, and I'll make that children's issue, I'll take out children's issue in that, I'll give nice place, nice space, I'll make that situation. By thinking that, I started this career. And day by day, I started writing by focusing children's in different local newspapers. And it was very difficult for me to write in only children, be it in first time. But local media gave me space to write in that children's issue. Later on, I started working with onlinekhabar.com. It is one of the popular news portal of Nepal. And in that, I focused issues of children, as well as I also started writing other issues of other different fields. And I again want to this. I want to expose the issues of children by focusing them, but by sitting in a zhapa, in a one district, it is not possible to write in only children bit. But I am planning of coming to Kathmandu and reading mass communications, and I want to continue this journalism with children's bit. Thank you.
So you started when Have you taken any trainings programs to write an article?
No, I haven't taken any trainings or other any kinds of program at the beginning. But firstly, I used to write article my that views, opinions on different children's issues. I had taken training of child right and so on. And first, in beginning, I used to write only about children's. But later on, I started reading articles of other different peoples, other different news from different newspapers, and I started practicing writing news. And later on, I improved my writing, and national media also gave me space to my news. And while I was reading in class 9, a national daily of Nepal, Kantipur also covered my one article, and later on I also wrote many articles on child right issues in that Kopila of Kantipur publication.
I mean, that's great, like starting from a very young age and having no experience of writing, and then you start writing it, you build up your skill and looking for platforms, and winning the award of the youngest journalist and working as a very influential journalist, I think have changed lives of many people because media is one of the powerful tools in any field. Thank you so much, Khabar. Coming to himself, like, you've been involved in so many youth activists, activism in your community. I think till now you have been doing this. Youth activism is actually a non-profit job, and then for 4 years you have been involved in this, 5 years almost, right? So what made you to follow your dream into this sector?
Back when I was like 13 or 14 years old, I came to a platform, unknowingly I came to a platform that was named Youth for Blood. So it was a group of youths who were trying to solve a problem in Gandhagar that was a blood crisis. And I went there through one of my sister, and I don't know where I was, I don't know what I was doing, but basically I was having fun there. People used to gather there, they used to share their stories, what have done throughout the week and what are their plans to next week, and it was a platform where you could express yourself and know about how people are living like in the same locality as you. And as I grew up in that organization, I came to know that I got an opportunity that very less people in our city has got. Very less people could access that facility, and a teenager is an age where we have a lot of things going in our mind. So, but we have very less place to express those feelings. A bunch of friends, or maybe a brother, or we don't have people who we can express what we think, and there are no any people who can actually mentor us, especially in a society like Nepal. And I continued with my work and with that platform, and I later found out that people are suffering. The teenagers, especially in Biratnagar, they don't have anything to do. What in free time? Here in Kathmandu, yes, there are a lot of fun parks and a lot of amusement parks and gaming places and. Yes, but there in Biratnagar, if we want to hang out with friends, we have either very expensive restaurants where we need to think before we get in, or local bars. So basically, we end up going to local bars and chat with friends. So we eat those things which I don't think we are supposed to eat, and then that's how we end up. So I came to know this after I was like, involved in those organizations. I came to realize, I knew that this is happening, but we don't realize the problem. So yeah, and after realizing the problem, I have tried to form a platform where people can come and express their feelings, a platform where they can be themselves, and platform where they can grow themselves in terms of like soft skills like public speaking and leadership.
So you saw that the very crucial age of teens and the crucial age of youths not going into very productive activities, but then wasting time in something else that is not supposed to be. So then you took this initiative to work. I mean, that's very inspiring, but then to taking the initiative and then to lead, right? Coming to Kelvin, very interestingly that you were also you were leading this child forum in Indonesia, and you've been helping teaching English to HIV/AIDS affected children in Indonesia. So how do you come up with this idea to follow this path?
Okay, thank you. So when I was first time of did volunteering when I was 17 years old. So at the time I'm in still 11th grade. So I joined the child forum in my city, Tasikmalaya. So at the time, I'm still not a leader at the time. So after 1 year, my friends and the government of the local government choose me to be a leader. So we making printing even in the local communities like International Youth Day, and so the young people can give a contribution to express themselves to the society. I mean, we want to accommodation to them to the kids, so the kids have more the feel to giving themselves creativity and empowerment to the others. And also right now I'm currently be a teacher as a volunteer in Yogyakarta. So you know, Indonesia is very interesting. Indonesia has one special ideology. The name is Pancasila. Pancasila is the ideology, so everyone, no matter who you are, no matter what is your religion, what is your race, you can live in Indonesia. That's Pancasila. So my big fears was the politician want to use a religion to get a voice. So I am as Indonesia people want to be make understanding to reduce the radicalism about that. So I read also on the blog about politics, about religion, about philosophy to make people understanding how the important thing to pluralism, how important thing is to make diversity. So Indonesia have a lot of races, have a lot of religion. So we want to live together, so peaceful. I don't want to make any war between religion about Muslim and Christian, for example. So I want to make empowerment to the people.
Politically challenged, equally diversity, and along with that, you took an initiative to create peace, right? I mean, that's again the huge thing that a very normal teenager would not even look into it. Like when I was a teenager, I had a very funny incident. Like we used to hear news, and whenever we turn on TV, whenever we see the newspaper, the first page is, the highlighted page is about politics. And you will not hear a very good political news, but then you will hear some kind of conflict, some kind of, disturbances or strikes. Then I had the perception of hating what politics actually is and hating the political leaders when I was a teenager. But as I then looked into and researched into how these problems are created, and then I find out, like, it's not exactly what I see. It's about sometimes how we judge things are like, you know, we judge things with one thing that you see, but you have to see a very, very, very diverse thing. And when you are so positive to learn new things and you are so positive to one problem, as he is looking into, like, he's creating peace, you know, trying to create peace in his own level, that kind of positivity comes in, then I think everything falls into a very learning opportunity for you and a very open-minded opportunity for you all. I want to know how does don't do it, we actually want to do it. When someone says, please don't go in the rain, we actually love rain and just go and enjoy, right? I'm now asking you a similar question to every one of the panelists. Please answer it like personally, because this is the age where you are mentally challenged. Obviously, we have social problems, you know, about parents, about society, being a girl or being a boy, you know, being a student or being very small or being very ugly maybe or being very used. We all have social problems, but moreover, these crucial age have the mental challenge inside. You know, the wild inside us of what I want to be and confused, should I listen to this or listen to that. Recently when we were writing about the, you know, out of the world topic, research papers, how many people said to you, you are crazy and I don't think this will work out?
Thank you for the question. And that makes me ponder again. Well, there was always support from my parents that something you can do, right? And always have a dedication on the thing, as mentioned earlier. There are many people who backbited, actually, to say. Like, they were my own friends. They used to say, okay, you're doing, like, in my own book, all those pictures that I have done, I have drawn myself. And I forgot to mention that I was also awarded the third prize in drawing competition organized by Nepal Rashtra Bank, among various more than 300 candidates. The drawings, I did it while I was drawing. I used to do it in the class sometimes, for a few drawings, not all. And they used to just mock up, okay, you are drawing, right? In this book. They used to mock it up. But later, when that got published, the same guy who used to tell that, did you draw this? So, there are challenges in life. But as mentioned, right, this, as our moderator asked, how to have a firm dedication. Now, as a teenage, before teenage, while I was studying in class 5, I had an aim. I had an aim to become a cardiologist. Now, that was what I intended from childhood. Now, that nobody could stop. By childhood, I loved to become a doctor myself. And by class 5, I had a dedication, I will be a cardiologist. And now I'm studying MBBS, second year, I will be a cardiologist. Now, that doesn't hamper my anthropology or other researches in case of physics or cosmos and other universe and so on. The thing is, you have to have a dedication from inside, an aim to achieve, following your intuition. Other things, you can do it. It's not that you just need to be one particular job and that's it. No, you can be like I'm going to be a cardiologist. Also, I'm interested in anthropology, cosmology, and many other. Choose the most interesting field you love and have an aim with it. There are other interests as well. Keep researching in that. Why to have a single title? Keep it multiple. Be the one, leave a mark on earth. Thank you.
Well, I mean, and few of the terms I'm missing for the first time, actually. Okay, so, Srijan, have you been mentally challenged sometimes when you were doing this in your journey? Some things didn't work out and you were mentally stressed and you found out some ways to handle.
To say, as I mentioned, that my research papers were selected by, I was invited from the Harvard University and Illinois State University. The thing is, I come from a middle class family. I'm not so poor, not so rich. Now, they invited me, provided me something like registration was free, this and that. But for tickets and half of the accommodation, I had to pay. Now, I couldn't pay the high cost. It was too high for our entire family. Now, I went in search of funding. I went to NASP, the place where I was the youngest. They themselves, they, along with UGC, University Grants Commission, and many other NGOs, and Asian Development Banks, and so on. But no one was ready to give me funding. Nowhere. I was mentioned by NAST and UGC clearly that if you are a faculty in a particular institution, that is, you have to be a teacher or a scholar or something like that, not a student, then we will provide you with the funding how much you want, or else we cannot fund. They also clearly mentioned that the thinking that the teenagers or the youths can research has not yet been developed here. So that's the reason I couldn't make it for Harvard and Illinois State University conferences, though I was invited. Similar cases now with the Switzerland. I've been invited for the Evolving Morphology Conference, that is a more than 200 years old conference, and my paper is selected. Among all those, I have been listed in Harvard and Illinois State University in Switzerland. That's the first representative from Nepal ever, and that was a teenage. But similar thing is going on with me. I cannot find the funding. Now, I couldn't find the funding, but the thing what I could do, this is a challenge, why not find a solution? I send my papers with abstracts, and they are being researched in different corners of the world. Not only this, many others, like Greece and so on. There are many Canadas and other countries are also researching in that particular. So I am not physically present there. However, if I get a funding, I will be able to make it. However, wherever I have not been able to due to my financial status, I have sent my abstracts, research papers, to be researched further. And I get the reply, and I'm in searching for other theories and hypotheses. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Before proceeding to question answer round that I got cheated about, question answer round, I still wanted to ask a few questions to all three of you, four of you. You know, we talk about this mental stress, and he has very less thing about it. Any one of you who have faced such, you know, crucial mental stress because of your society or because of your thing, and it was a hurdle in your case and in your dream. Any one of you have such experience and want to share?
I have some of my experiences. When somebody is coming in my room and they are talking with my father and mother in different issues, when I enter into that room, then they say, "Let's not talk now, you're a journalist, you write." Another experience, in classes, in college, when there is a small discussion or something like that, then if I go near there, then they say, "Don't discuss, you're a journalist, you may write, you write." I have other also many experiences like this, but I am not taking those things seriously. I just laugh at them and I ignore that. I am continuing in my this own profession.
I mean, that that is actually a positive thing, in personally I feel, because at least you have that degree of power and people consider your work as a very powerful tool, and your work that you have done so much more that you are one of the influencers to them, so that, you know, there cannot be anything as such until it's bad, it's not letting you do in front of press or journalist.
Yeah, but sometimes when my friends are talking in different issues, and if I go near to them, then they start talking about that.
Well, I think one day, as you know, we've talked in previous time, and as Shuja also mentioned, one day the same guy will be, or girl will be saying to you that, let's discuss, right? Last question to three of you, Nina, Insaf, and Kelvin. Let's try to make it very short. What would be the one thing, if given you the chance to change, what would you change one thing if you had a chance to change in this world?
Very tough question.
Okay, Insaf, do you have any? Let's make it very short, because I know so many of them, I can see questions in their faces, you know, they're eager to ask questions.
If I could change one thing in this world, then I would change the perspective of adults toward the teenagers. Like, people think these are teenagers. No, they can't do anything. No, they are not supposed to be here. No. So I'd like to change that perspective of people.
Thank you so much. Do you have anything to change? But only one thing.
Yeah. I have a goal to in the future. So if I want in the future, I want to be a social entrepreneur. You know, I want to make a company, but the profit, like 40%, I will give to the institutions, to an institution on care on the education, and also help to help the poor people in Indonesia, because some part of the island from the Papua, the small part of the Papua is don't not enough to reach the good education yet. I want to push the society to make the people higher education, high GDP in the Papua, so there are equality from the Papua in Jakarta. So I want to achieve that in the future.
Well, thank you, Kelvin, first of all. I now put this floor to our participants. You can shoot up questions. Yes, I told you that I can read questions in your face. You've stood up already. Yes, you have a question?
Namaste, it's me, Narayan Gautam. I am a social activist from Zapa. My question, while working for this society from the different field, what sort of problem did you face, and how you tackle with it?
This is a question to all the panelists. Can answer?
Yes.
Okay, any one of you can answer this question. He have asked, like, when you were working in your journey, what kind of social issues that you face?
So when I was high school, I joined activists also like you on the HIV AIDS, on health. So I was called by the government, Minister of Health of Indonesia. So I'm going to the Sulawesi, Makassar, for the national conference. I was giving speech to my experience during 1.5 years in Tasikmalaya, because I am as a teenager also with the other activists. But I'm the youngest at the time, because I was still probably 18 years old last year. So me with my team, with my friends, also give the teenagers peer to peer to, like, sex education to the teenagers, like to make them, you know, at least they can responsibility to what they do. So we want to reduce the HIV AIDS virus in Indonesia. So yeah, that's a interesting thing in my job during the volunteering and activist last year.
When I started doing all those activities, singing, acting, dancing, I had to sacrifice a lot of my free time for those activities, and my friends and family would suffer, and that was a bad thing. So sometimes I would just sit in my room and cry and feel depressed alone, but I felt so much negativity and from people that I cared about, from friends. They wouldn't support me. They just didn't care. But with time, I tried to, you know, change things. Like I said, you need to balance. And then everything starts to get on its place. So, yeah, I felt alone, and that was the biggest struggle for me. Being alone is the worst thing on this planet. So one friend from here taught me that you must have time for yourself and for your friends. Your family and friends are very important.
Any more questions?
Hi, I'm Ajmal from Bangladesh. My question is, whenever we start something different along with our studies, most of the cases we don't get support from our family, from our society. There are lack of mental support, there are lack of equipment. So how do we face this situation? Sometimes we don't get mental support from our surroundings, from our society, and we tend to think about giving up our passion. We just get out of all the things we love and just confine ourselves in only study and academic activities. So how do we overcome the mental crisis and the situation we face and overcome this situation and continue on our passion and continue what we love doing? It's not necessarily about entrepreneurship, but it's about the things we love alongside the academic activities.
I think that you need to think positive, and no one can be creative if they're afraid. You have to overcome that fear. You have to make yourself think that you're good enough. And then everything will come eventually. And being different is not a bad thing. It's a good thing. And it's very important. That's how we make differences. So, yeah.
Thank you. I'm Anand Hussain from Bangladesh. Actually, there is a discussion about social problem. My question that every day we facing a lot of problem. Actually, social problem, a lot of we can describe in a word. If you see that every day in our newspaper, we are reading that in here this girl raped, and every places a big emergency problem is situated day by day. So in my question that a lot of problem, but in how process we can solve emergency problem, in how process at a time, and this society day to day this problem will be decreased.
So your question is, how can we do
process? Actually, how can the process we can decrease such as emergency problem?
So his question is, how can we process the emergency social issues or problems?
Yeah.
So you process things. Can you be more clear on the process that you're asking to the analyst?
Yeah, actually anyone can tell my answer that how can participate we can solve this problem. Only government roles or any government help cannot solve this problem. But in how, in our society, people can solve this problem.
So his question is, when you face a problem in a society, like you face every day, how can we actually, you know, solve that from your side to the issues that you have in a society? And he's asking for the process that he can follow, every one of us can follow when we face the problem.
Thank you for the question. As I mentioned in my presentation, in the society, human beings are an integral part. We are the fundamental part of it. Always have a confidence in whatever you do. And eradicate the ill dogmas which you think are not good for the society at your own level. Because since we are the fundamental unit of the society, like the cell is the fundamental unit of life, if the cell dysfunctions, the entire body goes dismantled. In the similar case, you try to eradicate yourself in your way you can do. No matter what age it is, one is always a great in that particular case. Adapt to evolve for a change, but with a change within yourself. Thank you.
If I'm getting the gist of what Susan said, if you want to change the world, first change yourself. Is the gist of what you said?
Yes.
When you change with the perception of how you see the society and being positive about the things, and you change yourself according to the situation and you adapt accordingly, then only you see the problem differently and then you can face it differently. And that's what makes, you know, a very a different world in a very friendly world in what Srijan has said about you. I hope he's answered the question. One question is from Lal Babuji, representative of YY. So he has asked to the panelists, three things which you need from society to make it teen friendly. What are the three things which you need from the society to make it teen friendly? Teenagers friendly, teen friendly. What three things are needed in society to make teen friendly?
According to me, the three things that society must give to teenagers are, first, believe in them, mentor them, and help them if they are in need.
Yes, I'm starting, I mean, short and sweet, yes. The first one is mentorship.
Believe in them.
Believe in them.
And? Mentor them, and help them if they are in need.
Well, that's the main major thing that is needed, right? Thank you very much. We need one more question. Okay, so this is the last question, I suppose. I am seeing many hands. Can I ask to one who have not spoken in the previous panel?
My question is to, my name is Socio, I represent the Society of Nepal, and my question is to Annie. Question is, what are the ways to develop traditional song status that are being overruled by the newer ones?
Can you repeat your question?
What are the ways to develop traditional songs status being overruled by the newer ones?
So his question is about what are, you know, the traditional songs are being ruled by the modern songs. So he's asking about what are the ways that you can make these traditional songs, you know. Is that Sashi what you were asking for?
Like make them more common than modern songs. Yes, well, that's very difficult. world is changing like every day, and I actually don't know the answer for this question.
Can I answer Sachin's question? Similar, because I am into music, so sometimes the music that you follow have the trends, you know. When you have a war, when you have depression, when the whole society is into, you know, into poverty and everything, the songs that is very trendy is when you touch the heart of people, that is the sad song, and when you can relate that song to every other lives. And if you see in this generation is too busy in their work, too busy in their studies, too busy in their own way. So you are taking music as a refreshment, right? So for some, music, slow music or traditional music are refreshing to you. But most of them, the rock songs, the very metallic songs, the very fast songs, the songs that makes you happy is the most trendiest thing. So there's no way that you can dominate traditional songs over the modern songs. But what you can do is, the traditional songs can dominate when the trends happen. And sometimes this things works. Like when, I think when Nina is singing, you have probably the songs which is a very romantic, or let's say a very pleasing songs, or let's say sometimes very drastic to touch the hearts. But for most of the youths here, you want to, you know, dance off the floor, you want to jump over, because you want some kind of refreshing in that way, in the different society. And that what influences music.
Yeah, so I want to say that, like I said, the world is changing, and every single one of us, we are changing, and in every single part of our lives, we are listening to different kind of music, so you can't just put one type of music above the other, so music is music, and it's here for enjoyment.
So, thank you so much, Gina. Thank you, Srizan, Nina, Gaurav, Itzhak, Kelvin. I'm very pleased to moderate this panel and have a really great time discussion with about the social perspective. I hope you all have a great time here. I'm pretty sure most of your stomach is already sounding, right? Is it? I think now after this we have a lunch or something. Very good. I mean, I'm hearing mine as well. Okay. Thank you so much for the panel, and officially I end this social perspective panel. Thank you so much.
Thank you for sharing your remarkable insights on the social perspective. Well, I was so entertained and I was so motivated by this session. Thank you everyone for making it so lively, and thank you our moderator for making the interaction even more lively. So now, may I please call upon IT and Design Manager of Glocal Private Limited, Mr. Ajay Pandey, to give the tokens of love to our respected moderator and panelists. Our moderator, Ms. Alina Pajapati.